Well, good morning, everyone. And welcome to you, and welcome to you at home. Many people have been perhaps rightly wondering about the numbers of COVID cases in the community, so have exercised their right to stay at home, and hopefully you're tuning in. So welcome to all those at home, welcome to those who are here. A couple of things about our COVID precautions. We're now opening up the side doors at the front here to allow natural ventilation through, which is recommended. And also, where possible, during the service, the rear door is locked. That's to keep strangers from walking in, particularly when you've got children present in the congregation. But afterwards, we encourage you to take your cup of tea. And rather than being inside, how about being outside underneath the beautiful ash tree? You can sit on the chairs out there and have some nice fresh air whilst having cups of tea with people. So that's also considered a good thing in the current environment. So I'll certainly be doing that if you want to join me under the ash tree afterwards. Today we come before God in worship. Let us pray. Living God, not our will be done, but your will be done. Help us to come now with open hearts, open minds, the sense of anticipation. For behold, our Lord comes to us, full of grace and truth. Amen. Our band couldn't be with us today, but Glenys is holding the show for us. So, well, thank you, Glenys.
Thank you, Graham. What a gift it is to be here, isn't it? And also, I think a gift for all those who have decided that the best place for them is to be at home. It's an amazing what technology can do for us. So welcome to everybody who's at home as well. And here we are to worship God together, separate but together. So will you join with me now as we come into his presence? If you're at home, put down that cup of coffee. If you're here in church, let us settle our hearts and our minds and be still and come before our awesome and almighty God. Let us pray. Great Creator God, our Maker and our Saviour, we come before you this morning with praise in our hearts and upon our lips. Because you live and are among us today through the power of your Holy Spirit, so we know that you are here to receive our praises wherever we are, and we are humbled. We bow down before you and worship you. Oh God, you are never changing in your love for us. Graciousness, righteousness, and justice are your attributes. Always you are merciful to us when we call out to you. We give thanks to you for your mercy endures forever. With all the peoples of earth, we repeat the great refrain that your mercy endures forever. Thank you, our Lord, that in all the changing scenes of our lives, whenever in trouble or in joy, that we can still sing your praises. Thank you, O Lord, that when we are sad and distressed, that you comfort us and rescue us. Thank you, O Lord, when problems and difficulties assail us, making us fear greatly, that you surround us with your love. Thank you that as we live out our lives through childhood, through adolescence, to adulthood and old age, through living to being called home to you, that there you are constantly beside us, ready to guide us, comfort and keep us. You are the light of our life, shining down the way of life for us. Help us, dear Lord, to always choose to walk in your light. When we are tempted by the glitzy glamour of the world's shallow counterfeit, help us not to be enthralled by it, but rather help us through the guidance of your Spirit to discern truth from lie, right from wrong, wisdom from foolishness, caring from indifference, love from hate. Sharpen our consciousness so that numbing complacency is questioned and challenged, so that we too may become more like you, bringing your light to shine in the world's dark places. Lord, you are the only God who has given us your light. You are our God and we will praise you. You are our God and we exalt you. We give you our thanks, O Lord, for you are good and your mercy endures forever. Amen. And if you would stand, please.
Long reserved for a walk in this world, they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope in this world where we roam. Ancient words will guide. Ancient words, ever true, changing me, changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart. Holy words of our faith, handed down to this age, came to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful words of Christ. Holy words, long reserved for a walk in this world, they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words, ever true, changing me, changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts, changing me, changing you. We have come with open hearts, oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts, let the ancient words impart.
Well, don't we need the refreshing of our hearts in these times? And it's in the presence of our God that we experience that refreshing. Good morning, people here at worship, and good morning if you're at home looking online. It's our communion time. If you haven't already got your communion elements ready, then maybe you'd like to do that right now so that you're ready when we come to that moment. I want to read the words of Jesus from Luke's Gospel as he introduces this communion time, this Lord's Supper, this Passover with his disciples. He said, "I have wanted so much to eat this Passover meal with you before I suffer." And Luke doesn't tell us exactly why Jesus said that, but I suspect in the words, "with you," "I have wanted so much to eat this Passover meal with you before I suffer," that he really did want them, his friends and disciples, to be there with him. There's a longing in his heart for them to be present with him. And this is the heart of hospitality. This is the heart of hospitality. You know, the lovely meal that's so well prepared and so diligently set before a guest is a symbol of hospitality, of course. The comfortable, warm bed with all the facilities appropriate for the setting is a sign of hospitality, of course. But beneath those, at the heart of hospitality, is this longing for the guest to be present with the host. The longing for them to connect with one another in a deep and beautiful way. Wonder if you've ever been somewhere, you've walked into a home of a friend or a family member, or you've gone to a club of some sort, an organisation, even come to church, and you've been welcomed so warmly that you knew exactly you were meant to be there and you felt you belonged there. That's the heart of hospitality. We are guests in this communion meal this morning. And our host, the Lord Jesus Christ, representing the Creator God, so wants us to be here this morning, so longs for us and has been longing for us to come and connect with him. Hospitality is embedded in this communion meal. Paul says God is in Christ Jesus welcoming us into God's presence. Isn't that lovely? God is in Christ welcoming us into God's presence. And so when we eat the bread, the symbol of the body of Christ, when we drink from the cup, symbol of Christ's blood poured out for us, we accept God's invitation. We open ourselves to receive all that is here for us. And we are united with God. We are in common unity with God in that moment. We commune with God. I want to read, as we come into this receiving of the body and the blood of Christ, I want to read from Luke's Gospel the words of Jesus as he shared these things with his disciples. Then he took a piece of bread, gave thanks to God, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you, do this in memory of me. And in the same way, he gave them the cup after the supper, saying, this cup is God's new covenant, sealed with my blood, which is poured out for you. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you that you want us here this morning. You have called us into this place, whether it's here in this building or whether it's home. You have called us to share in this meal with you, to commune with you. And as we take this bread and we drink the wine or whatever symbol of wine we have to drink this morning, we pray that as we accept your invitation, we'll sense a deep awareness of your love and your mercy and your welcome of us as we are into your presence. Thank you, Lord. Amen. You may like to take your piece of bread. This is the body of Christ broken for you. Eat in memory of him. And take your cup of whatever. This is the blood of Christ poured out for you. May it keep you in eternal life. Would you pray with me? Lord, you refresh our hearts. Thank you. Amen.
A tale loosely based on a short parable that Jesus told. Once there were two brothers, the Blues Brothers, who lived in a small town. They had built their own houses. Luigi had built a tall brown house because he wanted his house to be taller than his brothers. Mario had built a small red house. They loved where they lived. They loved the sorts of things that they enjoyed every day. Like Luigi enjoyed riding Warren, his horse. And he especially loved his classic motorcycle that had been given to him by his cousin, Pastor Vic. Mario enjoyed his small red house. He loved riding his horse, Pesty, who nobody else seemed to want for some reason. But he enjoyed immensely. And he loved to ride around too on his prize red bike. But they didn't own very much. They were very poor, so they had to go out and work. And work hard. So they worked at the farm of Old MacDonald. Each day they would help out on the farm. They would feed the horses hay. They would groom them with a brush and get out all the dirt and knots in the hair. And they would give them water to drink. This happened day after day. But on this day, Old MacDonald came along. And he said, boys, you see this here round paddock? I want ye to be removing the rocks here. They're too big for a man like me. And so they did. They got to work straight away. And as they worked and pulled away the rocks, suddenly they saw something shiny and gleaming under the rocks. What's that? Said Luigi. It looks like treasure hidden in the field. Wow, what do we do? Said Mario. I know, said Luigi. We'll cover it up again and we'll go to Old MacDonald and we'll offer to buy this paddock. And then we will own the treasure as well. So that's what they did. They went off and asked Old MacDonald how much for the paddock. Old MacDonald was quite amused that they would want the worst paddock on his farm. And so he said, "Well, boys, that'll cost you $1,000. $1,000, they said, "That's very cheap." Pardon me, I meant $1,000,000, said old MacDonald, thinking they perhaps might be a bit simple. So they decided, wow, that's a lot of money. That is a lot of money. That would cost more than, well, we'd have to sell everything, said Mario and Luigi to one another. Mario thought about it, and he thought about his house and his horse Pesty and his bike, and he said, "I don't want to do it. I love what I've got too much. I don't want to buy. I don't think the treasure's worth it." Luigi had a think about it and decided, yes, the treasure was more important than everything else he had. And so he went off to the shop in town. Luigi asked, "How much will you give me for the house?" He said, "I'll give you $750,000. "Oh, that's not quite a million. I wonder how much will you give me for Warren, the horse?" "Wow," said the shopkeeper, "he's quite a prize horse. I'll give you $245,000. "Ooh, I'm still $5,000 short," thought Luigi. "All I've got left is the prize Triumph Classic motorbike that Pastor Vic gave me." "Okay, how much will you give me for the classic motorbike?" "Oh," he said, "well, it's a limited market, but I'll give you $5,000. "Whew," said Luigi, "that's just enough. I'll sell everything I have, and then I can buy the field." And so that's just what he did. He went back to old MacDonald, who had just bought a classic motorbike and was smiling from ear to ear. He'd also just bought a wonderful black horse called Warren. And he had also bought a lovely new house in town, a tall brown house. Luigi didn't mind, though. He knew what he wanted, and so he handed over the $1,000,000 and bought the round field with all the rocks. And there he took the treasure, and he was happy because now he could do the things that he really wanted to do in life. The treasure would enable him to do that. And of course, our story is not about money and that sort of treasure. Jesus told the story because God is the greatest treasure. Only God can enable us to do the wonderful things in life that will truly make us happy. But sometimes we must give up things in order to follow God, in order to get something better. And that's what Jesus was telling us. The greatest treasure is God.
Well, I think you know what we're going to sing now. We're going to sing "The Greatest Treasure in the Whole Wide World is Finding Jesus," isn't it? So may we have the words, please, gentlemen? Well, the greatest treasure in the whole world is peace with God.
Well, the greatest treasure in the whole wide world is peace with God. It's the oldest treasure in the whole wide world is peace with God. It's the only treasure that will never fade. Even death can't take it away. Yeah, the only treasure in the whole wide world is peace with God. You can live for happiness or live for stuff, but it's all gonna fade away. But you'll never ever feel like you've got enough, because it's all gonna fade away. The trickiest toys that money can buy are all gonna fade away. You can live this treasure in the whole wide world is peace with God. Well, the greatest treasure in the whole wide world is peace with God. It's the only treasure that Grace, you are star. It's all gonna fade away. The biggest house and the flashiest car, they're all gonna fade away. Earthly treasures like the morning mist are all gonna fade away. The greatest treasure in the whole wide world is peace with God. And the greatest treasure in the whole wide world is peace with God. It's the only treasure that will never fade. Even death can't take it away. Yeah, the greatest treasure in the whole wide world is peace with God.
Morning, everyone. My name is Alistair. I'm an elder here at Living Faith Church. Welcome to everyone at home. It's a funny thing. We have instituted these new programs that allow for people to not come into the church in person and participate with us from wherever they are. And the thing that stands out to me with that is that we've always needed it. We've always had people who couldn't come into church because they didn't have mobility, because they were unwell, because of small children, all sorts of things that have made it difficult for people to come into the building in person on any given week. And it's a real step forward that we've put a lot of work into making these things happen. It's been difficult, but I think it's a good thing. So we've got time of community news. Got some slides, and we've got a ladies' night out. As a younger fellow, I find that name awkward, but yeah, that's okay. And it's going to be at the RSL. Please RSVP. Please make sure that you're vaccinated. Don't say you are and then not be. You know, water force will get you. And we'll go from there. We've got a Lent series coming up, and I'm looking forward to this. I think Lent's a really critical part of our year, and I think it's worth thinking and praying through what Lent's going to mean for you, whether or not you're going to give something up for Lent, if that's part of your tradition, or whether you're simply going to set the time aside to pray and participate fully in the life of the church. We've got an annual general meeting coming up, which is in mid-February, and critically means that if you need to give in a report, such as myself, you need to do it before the end of Jan. So Bruce can help you with that. He's got templates available, and I recommend that you look to the church vision as part of your understanding for what it is that your group has achieved and maybe what they haven't over the last coming year. So we've got the family camp coming up. That's an open invitation to all of us. It's not restricted to people who have children. It's an everyone thing. And the theme this year is noticing God every day. I'm not planning this year. My lovely wife is. It's on the team. And it is a great help if you put in your application earlier than the last minute. If you also want to help, feel free to hit them up. And there are some books in the pond room just above the stage. Feel free to have a flick through, snaffle anything you want. If you don't, they're going to go into landfill. It's straightforward as that. Yeah, they'll be mulched. They'll go into a recycling, but right now, given everything that's going on in the world, they'll go to landfill. Because the shortages of AdBlue for our diesel trucks mean that recycling is very difficult right now. And the op shops don't want them. So it's time for us to come to terms with our rubbish. Cool. On an unrelated note, Jan is collecting things for people who do need stuff. Packs for Backs, it's a good cause. Look into it. Feel free to contact Jan. And she'll get you going. So from there, I'd just like you to remember that we have a wider community. There are people directly in front of us. They're the people we haven't seen for a while. And I ask that you think of them and keep them in mind as part of your prayerful week. Cool. I think, Brian, you're up.
Just before I lead you in prayer, I have a note from Joan Norris, who asked me to thank you for your love, for your cards and your calls and flowers that you received on the occasion of her 100th birthday last week. Thanks, Bill. Let's come before the Lord in prayer. Let's pray. Creator God and our loving Heavenly Father, we affirm with the writer of Ecclesiastes that you've made everything beautiful in its time. Everything you do lasts forever, and nothing can be added or taken away from it. You have set eternity in our hearts, and we thank you for the promise of eternal life in Jesus Christ, our Saviour and friend. We thank you for Jesus, who was often busy, but always had time for others. He still made time to stop, to rest, to worship, and to pray. He did not hesitate to call out injustice, prejudice, and distorted religious practices. We worship you and freely acknowledge that we cannot fathom what you have done from the beginning to the end. You teach us here that there is a time for everything and a season for every activity in this world. Grant us by your Spirit the wisdom to know when it's time to plant and when to dig up, when it's time to demolish and when to build, when to keep and throw away. May we know when it's time to weep and mourn. And we remember those who've recently lost loved ones, and we pray for them. May we know when it's time to laugh and dance. We pray for those who've celebrated recent significant events in their lives and give thanks. Show us when it's time to search and when the course of wisdom is to give up searching. May we know when to embrace and when to refrain from embracing, and when it's time to love and when it's time to hate. May we know when to be silent and when to speak up. We thank you for the life and witness of Desmond Tutu and people like him, who did not remain silent in times of oppression and injustice. May we recognise there's a time to kill and a time for war, but also remind us that there's also a time to heal and a time for peace. And we bring before you now those people who need your healing in their body, mind and spirit, and we pray in a moment of silence for them. We pray that you will be our comfort when we shed the tears of the oppressed and power is on the side of the oppressors. We ask you to bring righteousness to the place of judgment where wickedness is there, and to bring judgment both on the righteous and the wicked. We pray for a renewed sense of our being one in Christ this year, and a deeper sense of our belonging together, for a new joy in being the people of God, and a fresh delight in each other's fellowship. May our life together bring glory to you, our God. Holy Spirit, enable us to tell the good news of your love and grace to those we meet. We pray all these prayers in the name of Jesus. Amen. It's now time to bring our offering for the work of God in our community. Stewards will wait on us for the offering. I think you know the drill now to the plates will just pass by and you to lean across and put your offering in the plate. And while we're doing that, we will sing Seek You First, the Kingdom of God.
Stand up, please.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Lord, out of all that you have given to us, we give back to you. Help us not to be complacent, to be aware of the skills you have given us so that we can shed your love and your message to the world. Amen.
The second reading is from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, 1 to 8. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search, and a time to give up, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to mend, a time to be silent, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. This is the word of the Lord.
This is, as Ecclesiastes would say, this is a meaningless sermon. You don't often hear that, do you? You might hear those, but you don't often hear that being admitted. Today, we're focusing on Ecclesiastes, and it's all about examining your life. And Ecclesiastes, in one sense, is ruthless in examining what the average human life is like. This is the one that has the passage that vanity, vanity, all is vanity, just a chasing after the wind. There's so much of that in this particular book. Referring to what people normally do is an utter waste of time. Now, we've got to put a couple of caveats on that, and one of those is, of course, this is written hundreds of years before Christ. So their experience of God in their life was certainly not as intense as what Christ experienced and what Christ shares with us. There was no Holy Spirit dwelling in their heart. Also missing a lot of Jesus' teachings. A time to love and a time to hate. Jesus would revise that. There's a time to love and there's a time to forgive your enemies. So you get there's been some changes that Christ brings. But nevertheless, this passage is really important for us to hear, because what it's asking us to do is to examine our lives for pointless activity. It's really saying to you, to examine yourself and say, is my life actually worthwhile? Am I just wasting my time? And you know, the book of Ecclesiastes is written by someone who calls themselves the teacher, a son of David, king in Jerusalem. So could have been any of the kings afterwards. And and they don't give their name anywhere in it. And of course, that's not the point. But one thing that is obvious is that this person is one of the privileged ones who has enough resources that they're able to devote time trying out different things in life. They've had choices and options, and so they've tried living a life of self-indulgent pleasure decided that that was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. They've tried, the path of capitalism, accruing as much wealth as you can. Also decided that was actually a bit meaningless too, because the same fate awaits the pauper as it does for the wealthy person. And what's more, the wealthy person, he observes, is just as likely not to enjoy their wealth because they're always chasing more. So there's quite a lot of good insights about human nature in Ecclesiastes. But it's hard to read if you're not in a good mood. So let me give you a sample. This is chapter 1, verse 2. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. What do people gain from all their labours at which they toil under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets and hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the streams come from, there they return again. All things are wearisome, more than one can say. At last, a verse we probably can relate to in our COVID time. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear its fill of hearing. What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, look, this is something new? It was here already, long ago. It was here before our time. No one remembers the former generations, and even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them. Now, when I say it's a pretty heavy look at life and how it goes, and it does reveal a lot of things. Like for most of us, let me give you an example. All of you, your lineage goes back thousands of years. But how many generations do you actually remember? I guarantee you that for every person here, you have forgotten more generations than you remember of your own lineage. So he's absolutely right. You will be forgotten in years to come. Deal with it. That's what he's saying. And so he's asking in the midst of that, well, our challenge for us is that we also are people who have, as he puts it in chapter 3, verse 11, he has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. And so, again, he's talking pre-Jesus, and he's saying, who can figure what God's up to with this creation? And which is another theme taken up in Job. But at the same time, he's saying, yet somehow, eternity and the yearning for eternity and for the divine and the spiritual is in the human heart. And yet there doesn't seem to be a way to satisfy that. He goes on to say, how are we even different to the animals? Who's to say whether the animal's spirit goes down into the earth and the human spirit goes up into heaven? So he's saying there's a lot we don't know. And in his time, of course, Christ did not come. So he's just looking at human life, just as human life, as we live it on this planet. And he comes to the conclusion that so much that we do is pointless activity. We think we're building something for the future, but it's not going to last. We think we're achieving something by developing wealth and all that sort of stuff, but then it's distributed when you're gone. And he even goes on to point out how when it's distributed, it's often wasted by the next generation. So he's got a lot of unhappy insights to share with everyone. And so there's this thing of, therefore, examine your life. What is pointless activity in life? What is meaningless activity? And what is good activity? And of course, he struggled a bit in Ecclesiastes, because he didn't have Christ, to have a good tool to measure what is a life worth living. What is worthwhile activity in life? How do you measure that? So he was able to measure what's pointless activity, which is accruing wealth until you die, and then it's distributed. So that's pointless activity, because death makes it pointless. And he makes that insight on a few things as well. Death has a way of making things pointless. So let's see what he looks at in this passage. There is a time for everything. And what he's emphasizing in this is that in many ways, stuff happens to you in life that you have no say over and no control over. And this is his reflection that, what's the point of this endless round of activity? Life is seasonal. It just seems to have these repeating seasons, and it happens to everyone, one after another. So there's a fatalism about this passage. Sometimes it's seen as with a bit of hope, but we'll unpack it a bit. So the first thing that's pretty fatalistic is verse 2. A time to be born and a time to die. Now just raise your hand if you had a choice in the time you were born. Anyone? No, most of us didn't really. So that's how he begins this thing of, well, how much say do you have in life? And stuff happens to you. There's a time to plant and a time to uproot. And so he's referring to the seasons. So how much control do you have over the seasons when you plant and when you harvest? Well, you don't, of course. That's out of your control. So he's saying a lot of what happens to us in life is the seasons of life, if you will. And he goes on later and talks about how it's, young people should enjoy their youth while they can until you get older and have some of the problems of age. And he's not the first person to come up with this insight, I might add. But then he's got warnings about youth and warning about age as well. But the one thing that he's pretty plain on is that there's a sense in which we try and defy the seasons of life, in which we somehow yearn to stay young again, whilst the very young yearn to be older. There's a pointlessness to all this yearning because it happens to us. You don't have a say over the seasons of life. And there's an encouragement to that we come to terms with this, that we don't live in denial with the way life actually is. And so that's what this chapter 3 bit is on about. Don't live in denial that life is actually like this. Just accept that it is like this, and you're not the first one to go through the circle of life, as that great wisdom literature, The Lion King, calls it. So he goes on, he talks about other things. There's a time for war and time for peace. And again, for the great vast majority of people in those times, they had no say over whether they lived in a time of war or a time of peace. Other people did that. A few individuals at the top who exercised power. Whether you lived in a time of war or a time of peace, well, it happens to you. And that's the theme of all this. There's a time to weep and a time to laugh. And I was just, as we went through some photos, I was looking through the photos from the other day, and I noticed, you know, my mother was there, you know, at our wedding. But also we were there at her funeral. There's a time to weep and a time to laugh. And that's, this is what the thing's getting on about. The seasons of life, they happen to us. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and, which we now notice, a time to refrain from embracing. Some of these passages suddenly leap to the fore. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. And how true that is, certainly in our society and our time, our houses are constantly churning through possessions, and I can still remember how easy it was to move into our first place. You know, you could borrow a trailer from a friend and move your possessions. Then when we moved to Ashburton, the removalist truck, which came with an extra oversized trailer, was too small for the amount of stuff we had. And because, you know, with kids, you know, you get stuff and you tend to hang on to it as long as you can, and will the, you know, pass to the next generation, and et cetera, et cetera. And somehow, years on, you have an awful lot of Lego in your cupboard. So, a time to keep and a time to throw away. And so, you know, for many of you, you're experienced that or experiencing that or going through the midst of that, whether you're gathering stuff or whether you're throwing it away. So many people I know of also are having to decide as age moves on as to what size house you're going to live in, or whether to move to a nursing home, or how to move at all. And so many people, I've seen struggle with this, are in denial about the seasons of life and just wish that it wasn't so, and I'm going to stay here in this oversized house too long. Longer than I can take care of it, or I'm going to stay in this house, which is now dangerous for my health, for too long. And so on it goes. This thing of not examining your life, not coming to terms with, as Ecclesiastes says, the seasons of life, and acknowledging I'm not the first one to go this way, and I certainly won't be the last to move through the seasons of life. It's natural and it's part of what God has ordained from the beginning. So the passage goes on and it talks about many other things, including that verse 1 from chapter 1, verse 8, the eye never has enough of seeing. And I think there's a sense in which we've now entered an age which, before COVID came along, there was this explosion of tourism. And, you know, we gave ourselves the privilege of visiting nearly every culture across the planet because the eye never has enough of seeing. Our curiosity, our desire to see new structures and new peoples and so on, it's part of being human, yes. But the question is, you know, given how large a carbon footprint we have when we travel, will the eye ever have enough of seeing? And if we can't see, and this is what COVID has taught us, if we can't get out and about, if we can't go across borders, even to New South Wales or South Australia, what is life about? What is worthwhile activity in our lives? And I feel Ecclesiastes is holding up to us this question. You know, what is your life about? If it's not about chasing what the eye can see, if it's not about accruing more possessions, what is life about? What is meaningful activity and what is meaningless activity? And it's a challenge to us. And only you can answer for yourself in the presence of God. So let me summarise what Ecclesiastes is getting at here. There's an acceptance of the great circle of life, of the seasons of life. And it holds up the mirror to us and says, you have got to accept that this is part of being human. But there's also a rejection. This is the second part of Ecclesiastes, a rejection of pointless ambitions. Not all ambitions are pointless, and we'll get to that. But pointless ambition, such as the meaningless accrual of wealth, and there's never having enough. There's the rejection of, come back to that. Now, when Jesus has come, he adds another aspect to this, that we can evaluate whether our lives are just pointless or whether there's meaning to them. See, our society holds up to us, you've got a successful life if you have the houses, the family, the property, the experiences of going around the world or whatever, that's a meaningful life. Ecclesiastes says back to us, actually, most of that is not meaningful. It's a chasing after the wind. So what is meaningful then? Well, when Christ came, he held up another thing we should be ambitious about. And we sang about it before. Seek first the kingdom of God. And these other things, food, housing, security, these other things will be added to you. But get ambitious about the most important thing, seeking God's kingdom. And then you will have a meaningful life. And the meaningful life doesn't have to have any wealth in it at all. A meaningful life is given to the impoverished as much as it is to the wealthy. A meaningful life is about love. It's about being ambitious to be a Christ-like person. It's being about service. It's being about developing a spiritual relationship with God. And where Ecclesiastes says, all the wealth and stuff, you can't take it with you when you die. Jesus says, actually, a lot of this stuff you're ambitious about, you do take it with you when you die. Your relationship with God, you do take it with you when you die. Your trust and faith in God, you do take it with you. Your sense of community in and the church, your sense of being brother and sister in Christ, you do take it with you when you die. Your sense of peace in who you are, you do take it with you when you die. Your joy in life, you do take it with you when you die. And so there's a sense in which, and it comes down a lot of the New Testament letters, really work for the things that last. Set your sights on the things that God's kingdom are going to be made up of, and you will not be disappointed. All your efforts will not be wasted. They'll actually bear fruit because you do take it with you when you die. And the yearning for justice and the yearning for a beautiful world is satisfied in the kingdom of God. And is being satisfied in this life and the next. So Ecclesiastes, yeah, it gives you half the story and says death is the end, and it makes you realize a lot of activity we do in life is pointless activity and meaningless activity. But Jesus takes it to the next level and says, yes, but there's a whole lot of stuff you can do in this life that is meaningful It just doesn't look like what the world calls success. But it is meaningful. And when you do it, when you participate in it, that's when you know it's meaningful. So finally for today, I ask you to invite you to examine your own life. Actually, is there stuff that I'm doing that is meaningless, pointless? And some of us are scared to actually look. Honestly, we're afraid that if we look, we might find stuff that you've been wasting your time, that there has been such wastage. So I invite you to look. Do it in quietness. Do it at home or on a walk. Do it in God's presence. Have a conversation with God about it. And do not see this as a pointless activity, but see it as the beginning of something new. That you might be able to set aside some stuff that you've been putting your energy into and start something different. Let us pray. Oh God, thank you for the Ecclesiastes, the harsh words that make us open up our eyes. Forgive us, our God, for not looking at our lives, not examining ourselves, not doing a bit of careful thinking. But now we pray, help us this week, perhaps this very day, to spend some time with you. Reveal to us what you can see. Encourage us once again to follow Christ, to set aside the things that we should set aside. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen. Now feel free to join us for a cuppa and or for time, well, and time up underneath the ash tree. I'll be on leave from tomorrow for a couple of weeks, but Vic is back. Enjoy having Vic. And now go to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.